Often, when you want to transfer money or pay a bill, you want it to happen instantly. And sometimes you could do that. For instance, if you want to transfer money from your savings account to your checking account, you can do that instantly if both accounts are at the same bank. But if the accounts are at different banks, then it will usually take 3 business days to transfer the funds, which may incur charges for insufficient funds. Other ways to pay instantly is through PayPal or Venmo. But both the payer and the recipient must have accounts for those services because these services depend on their closed-loop system to transfer funds between the payer and the recipient instantly. The Federal Reserve is launching a new service called FedNow that will allow anyone in the United States to make payments or to transfer funds instantly to most recipients in the United States. This video will show how money is transferred electronically and how it is transferred in blockchains and the difference between open-loop and closed-loop systems. I will also discuss the ACH network, the wire services, and the new FedNow network, and the advantages and disadvantages of each service. Closed-loop systems refer to payment options offered by a single central provider, in which both the payer and the payee must maintain an account with that provider to transact. In such systems, it is straightforward to transfer funds from payer to payee nearly simultaneously. However, the payee's ability to then use the funds received for payments outside the closed-loop network typically requires a transfer to an account at another financial institution, which can take much longer. Money is a means of payment, a unit of account, and a store of value. For most of history, money was represented as coins or currency, or by some other scarce object. But as we shall see, there is nothing about the essential nature of money that requires it to be physical. It can be electronic. Indeed, electronic money has many advantages over physical forms of money, especially in a modern economy. Physical forms of cash, such as currency, cannot be transferred electronically, and they provide only one piece of information for a transaction, which is the amount. Ownership is established by possession. Cash can easily be transferred simply by giving it to someone else. However, physical cash cannot be transferred electronically. Only information can be transferred electronically. The key to transferring money electronically is by changing the very nature of money from a physical form to an electronic form. Instead of using a physical object, such as currency, to represent money, money can be represented as information stored in a record, in a database. So if John Doe sends $2,000 to Jane Doe, then John Doe's account is debited $2,000 by his bank. Then his bank sends a message to XYZ Bank to credit Jane Doe's account by $2,000, which is done through software by XYZ Bank. A confirmation of the transfer is then sent from XYZ Bank to ABC Bank. It is obvious that representing money as records in a database requires precise protocols and procedures to operate successfully. This is why financial institutions are tightly regulated, and messages, records, and procedures must be standardized for software to operate without error. Only members of the network can use the messaging system by following the protocols and other requirements of the network to ensure the integrity of the system. Electronic messages must be standardized so that software can process the messages without error. This ISO standard for exchanging electronic messages is becoming the standard format for the future, and it will be used by FedNow. One benefit of a complex message format is that much more information can be conveyed rather than just the amount being transferred. For instance, invoices can be delivered over the same messaging system used by the payment system so that the recipient can respond to the invoice by immediately paying it using the same messaging system. This is much easier than receiving an invoice by email, then logging on to your bank to make the payment. Using a standardized message to transfer funds will simplify the automation of funds transfers, such as automatically updating accounting systems. A more robust message format will also enable so-called smart contracts, where the transfer of funds could depend on other factors. This is the supreme advantage of representing money as database records rather than as a physical counterpart, such as coin or currency. Transactions in cryptocurrencies occur in much the same fashion. The main difference is that cryptocurrencies use blockchains, which are a special type of database. Transferring funds occurs in the same way as with traditional financial institutions, by debiting the payer account and crediting the payee account. Accounts are represented by specific addresses rather than names, which is why cryptocurrency transactions have some anonymity. As with more traditional methods of sending money, blockchain messages are highly structured so that the software can unambiguously interpret and complete transactions. Most public blockchains, such as the Bitcoin blockchain, are closed-loop systems since anyone who wants to transact in Bitcoin must have an account controlled by private keys that can send or receive Bitcoin. Even though there are many copies of some blockchains, such as with the Bitcoin network, they represent only one database, since all the copies have the same information. To summarize, money is transferred by destroying it in one database record and creating the same amount in another record. Why does it take so long to transfer funds from one institution to another, especially considering that transfers are done electronically, which can move messages fast, near the speed of light? Bureaucracy is one answer, probably the reason why it takes 3 business days to transfer funds between institutions. Many transfers use the automated clearinghouse network, usually abbreviated as the ACH network, since this is one of the cheapest networks to use. ACH transfers are done in batches 4 times daily. Transfers usually take 3 business days. The transfers can be faster, but it costs more. Transfers can either be credits or debits. The payer in an ACH credit transaction authorizes their bank to move money from their account to someone else's. Example of ACH credits include the direct deposit of paychecks, Social Security benefit payments, and income tax refunds. ACH debit transactions pull money from one account and send it to another. ACH debits can be authorized manually or scheduled to take place automatically for recurring payments. Many people make mortgage payments and credit card payments this way. Besides the ACH network, there are several wire services which can transfer money faster, but they cost more. The Federal Reserve Wire Network, otherwise known as Fedwire, is operated by the Federal Reserve Banks. Although it provides real-time gross settlement, it is not available 24 hours, and it is closed on weekends and holidays. The CHIPS network is privately owned by about 50 financial institutions, operates from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Time, but does not provide real-time processing, although most payments settle within one day. The RTP network was created in 2017 by 50 large U.S. banks, but supports only credit payments. Payments are irreversible and guaranteed, and they can provide additional information, such as bills and invoices. There is also the SWIFT network that is used mainly to transfer funds among banks in different countries. As you can see, there are differences between costs and settlement times among the different payment methods. Every bank participates in the ACH network and has the lowest cost per payment, which is why it is the most used payment network. The Federal Reserve is setting up a new system called the FedNow system that will allow instant payments to many more institutions. Access will be provided through the Federal Reserve FedLine network, which serves more than 10,000 financial institutions. The FedNow service will be designed to maintain uninterrupted processing 24 hours per day, every day of the year, with security features to support payment integrity and data security. It will be available to depository institutions in the United States and will enable individuals and businesses to send instant payments through their depository institution accounts. However, only domestic payments will be covered. Because the payments are instant, the main disadvantage is that they cannot be reversed. The service will also be one of the cheapest available, only 4.5 cents per credit transfer, including returns, and a 1 cent fee for a request for a payment message. As with the ACH network, banks may decide not to charge customers for using FedNow, since transactions are less costly to process than checks. There is a default credit transfer limit of $100,000, but financial institutions can increase that to $500,000. The Federal Reserve may adjust this limit after more real-time experience with the network if it is advantageous to do so. FedNow payment methods include virtually all types of payments people make, including person-to-person, consumer-to-business, consumer-to-government, and the reverse transactions. However, it will not support pool transactions. I suspect that the main reason for this is because FedNow transactions will be immediate and irrevocable, so there would be some risk in allowing other parties to withdraw money from an account at their own initiative. Most payments will be completed within 5 seconds, from initiation to receiving notification that the payment has been completed. You will be able to move money instantly between accounts at different institutions, such as between a savings and a checking account at 2 different banks. You can send money to Treasury Direct instantly to buy I-bonds or treasuries. You can pay the IRS instantly, receiving a receipt as a record of your payment. You can also instantly transfer money to and from a digital wallet. A great benefit for businesses is that they will be able to use the Request for Payment service. The request is filled out on a form in an app provided by the business's bank. The details and steps required for the request for payment service will depend on the app provided by your financial institution. To use FedNow, financial institutions must choose to adopt it. Many financial institutions have been testing the FedNow system and many of them have declared their intent to begin using the service when it launches in July, including a diverse mix of financial institutions of all sizes, the largest payment processors, and the U.S. Treasury. The FedNow service will be released in phases, and additional features and service enhancements will be introduced over time. Thank you very much for your time. If you liked my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I would appreciate any suggestions, so please leave them in the comments below. Check out my website at thismatter.com for more than 850 in-depth fundamental tutorials on personal finance, investments, and economics. Check out my books on money at williamspaulding.com. Thank you.